Hello, everybody. Welcome back to the Hearthstone Thailand Major. We're live from the Pantip Esport Arena in Bangkok. My name is TJ. I'm joined by Pathra for this next game.
Hey, TJ.
Hey. I'm excited for this one. Both these players are, well, we've come to learn who Letta is over the course of the past couple months.
Definitely, especially since he was the winner of the Southeast Asia Summer Preliminaries. So he's going to be representing Southeast Asia in the APAC.
Yeah.
Soon to come, which you will be there.
I will be, yeah. It's in just a few weeks, actually. The Americas Championship starts this week. It's in like 5 days or something like that.
How do you do it, TJ? You're all over the place.
I am. It's a wild ride, but thus is the esports life. And you can see the schedule there on your screen. We have four more matches remaining. This is going to be the round of four lower brackets, the lower bracket semifinals. So that'll be two matches in the lower bracket finals, and of course the grand finals. And it is a true grand finals because since we had a lower bracket, Shy will actually have two opportunities to win if he loses. Since he came from the winner's bracket, he gets the winner's bracket advantage, which means whoever comes to challenge him in the lower bracket will have to win two best of fives to take the tournament.
And we're actually really, really close to finding out who the winner is. Just...
Yeah, it's going to be pretty exciting. There's six players left remaining, and you can see here on your screen the six players that are left. It's Letta Chonger, Shy, Jackpot, BH Warwind, and Gogong Singh.
Yeah, actually, Jackpot is going to be matching up with BH Warwind, probably while we're doing this match.
No, it'll be on next, I think. This is just the first one. I'm pretty sure Jackpot and BH Warwind will be on stream.
Okay.
Unless they're worried about time, but I don't think they should be, so we'll get a word on that next, but that should be the next match coming up. Every match from here on out is an elimination match, though. We have the top six. It's just a matter of what place they get in the top six. So whoever loses this will get fifth six, and whoever loses the other lower semifinals will get fifth six. And then from then on out, it's just fourth, then third, and then the second place.
My, how time flies. And it's actually pretty cool because these players are from different countries. As you can see, Letta is representing Thailand, and Gogong Singh is a Korean player. And actually, Gogong Singh is a Twitch streamer, so hello to all of his viewers on the Twitch chat. What do we call them? Gogongians?
Gogong Singers. There you go. But yeah, Gogong Singh, a very heavy ladder player, has a lot of... This little shy smile. Someone's like, hey, you're on camera. He's like, oh. You should be used to it by now, though. As well as Letta, he's actually been in the spotlight quite a bit recently, getting guaranteed top six in this tournament, as well as the win for the Southeast Asia preliminary. So definitely a player to look out for in the future. But Korea has dominated Asia Pacific so far this year, having both the winter and spring champions, and probably even regardless of who qualifies for Asia Pacific, they'll be the favorites going in just because of the strength of the region.
I mean, yeah, Koreans have always been strong players. They have a huge gaming scene over there. Mm-hmm. I know that they get two seats, right, in Korea?
For Asia Pacific?
Yeah.
They get two seats. They've had three in the past because of Handsome Guy, basically. They get two seats, one player that wins the preliminary and one player that wins the most recent season of OGN. And they've gotten three seats because there's also a seat that goes to the highest point earner out of all the players in Asia Pacific, which was Handsome Guy for both winter and spring because he just has 50 more points than the next person in line.
He's like a beast. Yeah. Oh, my goodness.
He is the highest total point earner for HT points for any player in the world.
Yeah, so he's sitting comfortable right now. That's why
he's already at BlizzCon, so it doesn't even matter. Like, his points literally don't matter right now because he's going to BlizzCon. It's just sort of bragging rights at this point. But yeah, Korea also is the region with the only player to make it to BlizzCon twice, which is Kranich. I'm trying to think of other accomplishments Korea has in Hearthstone. They dominate every other esport.
Yeah, I mean StarCraft, right?
Well, StarCraft, League of Legends as well. Just a bunch of different esports. Heroes of the Storm, kind of now.
What about Overwatch?
Well, there hasn't really been much international play for Overwatch. The Koreans haven't really played against the Western teams yet. So we're not sure, but it's a possibility. They're showing promise. They have a lot of competitive structure over there, but Hearthstone is no different. Hearthstone, they haven't had a grand finalist yet at BlizzCon. Like, they haven't had a Korean player make it to the grand finals, mm-hmm. or even make it to the top four, I don't think.
Might be this year.
It could be. Yeah, this might be their year. They have Dainee and Handsome Guy already going to be there.
Yeah.
And they probably showed some of the best play that we've seen out of any player that's won a championship.
Yeah, both of them are really, really good players. Let's talk about the bans. Since we know the bans, Leta's mid-range shaman or totem shaman has been banned. And Gogong Sing's discard warlock has been banned.
Really interesting. I agree with Gogong Sing's ban because there's no warrior. So banning away the shaman is sort of the next worst thing.
Yes.
Even if you just go strictly by win rates, but even if you look at matchups, that's the worst. Leta's ban against the discard Zoo is interesting because the standard Zoo should, I don't know, on paper I feel like it should beat it. Maybe the druid should be pretty good against it. I feel like a shaman would have been a better ban in that case, or even a warrior. Warlock would have been like my third choice.
I feel like he thought ahead and thought like Gogong Sing is definitely going to ban his shaman, and that's like shaman is always good against Zoo.
Well, I think, I don't know, it's really close. Like, that's the closest of the matchups.
We're trying to get into their heads right now.
Yeah. Maybe he just doesn't like playing against Warlock.
Yeah,
I don't
maybe.
Even know.
It's all about what they're comfortable with, I guess. So we're going to see in game number one, Gogong Sing's Dragon Warrior versus Leta's Miracle Rogue, which actually doesn't have any questing. It's like the classic Miracle Rogue.
Really don't like this deck right now.
You hate the Miracle Rogue? Why?
Well, I like the Questing Adventure version. I feel like you need more dynamic win conditions against the decks that are a little bit faster. This version of the deck, I think, is much weaker against Dragon Warrior. Because Dragon Warriors lack hard removal for lots of big threats.
Right.
But they can deal with lots of small stuff because their minions are overstatted for their cost because of the Dragon Synergy. So they don't deal with Questing Adventures very well. They have to have Execute, and they're not going to keep Execute in their early hand. So a lot of times with the Questing Adventure version, you can just race.
Yeah, I agree with that. What do you think about Backstab Coin SI here? Or Backstab and just Hero Power and hit? Because, I mean, you're not going to get the SI agent combo next turn, most likely.
It's really tough because you know that you're... I would actually just prefer Coin Edwin, to be honest. Your next turn, a 3-drop for Warriors are usually 3/4. Either they play another 2-drop or they play a Fierce Monkey or a Frothy Berserker. And so either way, he wants to probably save Coin or Backstab SI at least for one more turn.
Right.
And... See, this is another reason why I like the Questing Adventure version, because in that situation, you feel like you could go with Coin SI or Coin Edwin more because you have another big threat in Questing Adventure that you can have for later. But this situation, Leta, I think, felt like he needed to hold on to the Edwin for a really big Edwin. So he had to just take extra damage in place of it.
Yeah. And I was actually just about to say that like his winning factor is based on this kind of Edwin Van Cleef.
Yeah.
It has to make it big, conceal it. And hope that, you know, Gogong Sing does not have the Ichor Execute, which he does actually in his hand right now.
Yeah. And I like the face push. Rogues usually don't have ways to heal up, but Leta does.
Yep, because without the Questing Adventure, you do have the Farseers.
Yep, and you have Violet Teachers. You just have a lot more room to put stuff in the deck, but that's such a safe play. I don't know. This is just playing a Violet Teacher to have it be thrown out there to die, and this is exactly what Dragon Warrior wants to do. Kill a minion, develop a minion. Every single turn. That's what it excels at, and that's how Gogong Sing is going to win this.
And we've seen one execute already, so Leta knows that he probably doesn't have the other one.
Yeah. Leta also saw that, hey, you didn't have a way to get through my Twilight Guardian last turn. Why would I trade? I'm going to put you at 15, activate my Draconic Crusher. And put you in the same exact position that you were in last turn.
Yeah, this is actually doing... Gogong Sing is actually dealing a lot of damage. The game is going to be over pretty soon. Unless Leta has a way to... He doesn't even have his sap.
Well, he can Blood Mage, Prep Fan, and evaluate. And then Edwin for a 8-8, as well as clear everything off the board except for the 3-1 Alex as champion.
Yeah, I really like the Edwin here.
He is at 9, though. And Gogong Singh has passed the sap check 3 turns now in a row. So he can probably just push face again. And that way, Leda has to find a way to deal with the 9-9, and he doesn't. So he'll be able to heal up with the Earthring Farseer. Oh, wait, you know, he doesn't have a way to deal with it, but he has to take 3 if he does it that way.
Right.
I don't know.
Do you think he even has room to Gadgetzan here and then coin? Or do you think maybe he should just see what he gets from his Thalnos first? If he gets a sap, that would be good.
Yeah, that Thalnos is going into that 9-8 no matter what, so. Yeah, I think he's just going to make the trades. Conceal this Auctioneer.
Mm-hmm.
And hope that he can win the game before Gogong Singh can piece together 6 damage.
And he definitely has to make the trade here, or else he dies.
Gogong Singh is like, okay, how am I going to deal this the rest of this 6 damage? And doesn't draw on anything yet, but Rag could be a big deal in this game.
Definitely. Rag could just go face him, and that's going to be it.
We also have to think about the Earthring Farseer that might be able to put him out of range of a lot of things. Put him out of range of a crazy rag shot. It put him out of range of, you know, a fiery war axe, mm-hmm. like 1 fiery war axe.
Yeah, actually, he's actually going to cold blood here and then Earthen Farseer. So yeah, he knows that it's turn 8 is coming and he doesn't want a rag or a Grom. But even the Grom wouldn't have killed him though. Just the rag. No dragon synergy. I still think he... Okay, well, he has the choice now. I think maybe the Grom is better at this situation. Yep. He's going to take out this Auctioneer.
I don't know.
Would you just 1-3? Oh, no, actually, it's not even a 1-3 because he's at 9 HP. Because if it hit face...
I might actually... Okay, so there was 11 damage on board. He was at 26. So Leda would have to piece together 15 damage from hand. Yeah, I guess so.
Hmm.
I was thinking maybe just Grom face.
I think he just doesn't want Leda to draw anymore.
Yeah.
And getting rid of that 1 extra minion would help his rag later on.
Dragon would be pretty good here, but doesn't pick one up, but does get Fiery War Axe.
It's time for the rag, and he's hoping to get the 7-3, or even the 4-4 would be great. But nope, it gets the face, which is something he did not want. You can see that he's just really annoyed by that.
But I think that just wins him the game. Because he can just Fiery War Axe next turn. Leda doesn't have enough damage to kill him. He's at 11.
Yeah.
He's 1 damage off.
I know. I was actually about to say that. 1 damage off is just nuts. So, oh my goodness. But Gogong Singh thinks he's in a lot of trouble, though.
So
but he's realizing, wait, actually, Leda might not even have it.
He hasn't had, like, damage for the last couple turns. He used his Grom. So Leda is just going to go for it here.
He's actually thinking if he plays the Leroy, Gogong Singh might just concede. Or no.
Yes, see Gogong Singh's face. He's saying, oh man, he doesn't have it. That's not enough.
It's not enough.
And 1 damage off.
But no, he's still going to watch and he's actually relieved to see that every single card was played and it wasn't enough.
Yeah.
But yeah, you never would concede, right? Until you actually see yourself in a tournament actually lose.
In the lower bracket semifinals of a major? No way.
Exactly.
You're not conceding until your hero portrait blows up or your opponent has exact lethal on the board.
Mm-hmm.
So Gogong Singh takes game number 1 with the Dragon Warrior, a very close matchup. And I don't know.
I'm sure his heart was like, oh my gosh,
yeah.
I can't believe it. It was so close, it was like 1 off for Leda. Very, very tight.
So, I don't know. I don't think that version of Rogue is good enough against Dragon Warrior. Mm. There was a reason why Dragon Warrior was considered a favorite for a long time, and a reason why people recently switched to say that Rogue is it's 50-50 or that Rogue is favored, mm-hmm. because of the fact that the questing adventure Rogue is much more put much more consistent pressure on the board early on because you have three things that can just get huge and you can race. Whereas with this version, it was just Van Cleef. Yeah. And then he was out of gas. Yeah.
Totally agree with you there. I just remember my Dragon Warrior in the ladder was beating a ton of rogues. And then all of a sudden, I got faced with the questing once. And I was this is kind of hard now.
A concealed questing adventure can just kill you. You have to have execute. And, you know, even though Warrior has the best removal in the game, Dragon Warrior only runs the two executes as their removal. Mm-hmm. They don't even have spells that deal damage. Like, Druid doesn't have really hard removal except for Mulch, but they have Wrath and Swipe and Living Roots and spell damage built into the deck more so than...
Mm-hmm. Feral Rage.
Yeah, Feral Rage, Shaman's Head. Well, yeah. Feral Spirits. Or Feral... Oh my goodness, what's it called?
I thought we were talking about Druids.
Yeah, we are talking about Druids. Is it Feral Rage?
It's Feral
Rage. For some reason, I thought Feral Spirits.
I was like, wait, are we going into Shamans now?
Oh, my goodness. It hasn't even been that long of a day yet. I'm already mixing up the Feral cards.
You're just getting too excited, TJ.
Yeah, yeah. I think I looked down at Shaman at my notes, and I was like, wait a second. Shaman, Feral Spirits, it's got to be what she's talking about.
Well, we might be seeing Shaman, Gogong Sing's Shaman next turn, so... Mm-hmm. And he's also got his Tempo Mage with a Medivh, the Guardian.
Also a Blizzard. Two Flame Strikes, a Blizzard, and Medivh with a Tempo Mage package. I really like it. I've been trying to play around with a Medivh Tempo Mage version, and I feel like you need a little bit more stall. You need to play a little bit more slow, and I tried with Cabal's Tome.
Right.
But it's not that good because you're sort of doubling up on extra tempo. Or you're doubling up on the grindy part of it. So what you need to do with Medivh is double up on the stall point because Medivh is already going to give you extra tempo because it summons minions. So I really like it, and I'm really excited to see that. So I hope we get to see the Tempo Mage from Gogong Sing. Yeah. It's very likely at this point.
It'll be a good match for sure.
Wait a second.
So game number two, Leta with the Rogue.
It said his Warlock was banned.
Yeah.
On the... Overlay. Okay. His Warlock's not banned.
Maybe, I guess his Warlock's not banned.
So, I'm guessing his Shaman's banned. Because he played Dragon Warrior, I can't imagine anybody would ban Tempo Mage.
Yeah, and you were saying, why would he ban the Warlock?
That's
right?
Why I was, I was so confused why he would ban the Warlock. I would think it would be Dragon Warrior midrange Shaman. So we are going to get to see the Warlock. This is a discard zoo. Double Soul Fire. Double Doom Guard, double Silverware Golem, double Malkasir Zimp, double Darkshire Librarian. Mm-hmm. No Fist of Draxxus, though. Waiting for that card to make an appearance.
Well, people said that it was bad. Like, we see a couple of them on the ladder, but then someone was like, you know what? That is actually a bad card.
Yeah. Darkshire Librarian's a little bit more consistent in a discard deck because at least it draws a card afterwards. It's not clunky. It's a 2-mana 3-2, which is, you know, equal stat line. But 4 mana to deal 4 damage, if you can't play it without the discard effect, like being relevant, 4 mana for 4 damage is bad.
Yeah. That was such an awkward turn. Did you see that for Leta?
Yeah.
His turn 3, he just had to hero power.
Yeah, but Leta's got a pretty good hand other than that against Zoo. He's got Vile Teacher prep Phantom Knives. Whereas the Questing Adventure version is better against other decks in the format. The Vile Teacher version is much better against Zoo.
That's true.
Because you're much more grindy, you have more early minions that you can just plop on the board and say go. So that's why Questing Adventure Rogue sort of became more popular, was because there was less Zoo in the meta.
So do you think he's going to drop the Teacher here and then...
He can play Tomb Pillager and then try and roll into Violet Teacher, Deadly Poison, prep Venom Knives next turn. Mm-hmm. He'll also have a coin, so if he picks up... I guess he could conceal, but I definitely think that Tomb Pillager is the way to go.
Do you think he... Yeah, okay. It is a nice turn, but Soulfire...
I don't...
Yes, so we have confirmation that the shaman of Go Gong Sing is banned.
Okay.
So both their shamans are bad. Well, no shamans here.
This could be a huge swing. Go Gong Sing could go for a 50-50 for Silver Rock Golem here with Flame Imp, Possessed Villager, and Soulfire. And it looks, he's going to go for it. This could be huge. If he spawns the Silver Rock Golem onto the board,
lights
out for Letta. Let's see.
Nope.
Oh. And Defender Vargas being discarded is actually a big deal because Defender Vargas is one of the best cards against Rogue if you're the Zoo player.
Right.
And with Shadow Strike drawn, I guess it doesn't matter too. No, it does matter, I think. But this has to be the turn that Letta goes for a big swing with Preparation and probably Violet Teacher because he's taking a lot of damage. And Go Gong Sing, his head is in his hands. You can tell that. I mean, imagine the landscape of this game if Silver Golem was on the board and Defender Vargas was in his hand.
Yeah.
Oh, well, yeah. I guess Violet Teacher not being used, but this is still pretty good. He's taking
most of the board out here.
He's taking 5 power off the board. Yeah.
So now he's actually stabilized, and Go Gong Sing has just. He's going to have to tap and see what other stuff he can get. Another Soulfire.
Well, that is going to be good for the following turn. Maybe he goes for another 50-50 here. I don't know. Asterix is very threatening. Okay, he's not going to go for it.
Save it for later.
Shame. I mean, it might have been better that because Rogue is in such a great position now with an Asterix surviving for a turn. I might have tried to go for it again. I think the potential of having a Silver Golem on the board and the Asterix gone is much more. And he lost the last one. I mean, what are the odds that you lose the 50-50 twice in a row?
I'm thinking of what the best play here is for Letta. I would like to see the teacher already making some tokens.
I like teacher, Cold Blood, Conceal. Then he sets up for lethal next turn. It's almost a guaranteed win as long as Go Gong Sing doesn't kill him or draw into the second Defender Vargas, which is really unlikely. Since the first one's been discarded, so.
Oh my goodness. And this time, Soulfire can't even kill the Azurdrake. Oh, double Soulfire, though.
Well, he's got 8 damage from hand. So he's got to win the 50-50 here to have a chance, and he doesn't get it.
Oh, that is. The discards aren't going too well for Go Gong Sing.
Yeah, so if he discarded Silver Golem there, he could have tapped, and if he drew 2 damage. He would have had lethal. Oh, my goodness.
Oh, my.
He's going to be 4 damage off. That would have been game if he had discarded the Silver Rock Golem. That is crazy.
That is nuts. It's because of that one little thing changed everything.
2 50-50s in a row, and Letta should be singing praises right now because that rogue should not have won that game.
Well, you know, sometimes it happens. This is Hearthstone. Sometimes the RNG is just, it's not your day.
And right now it's really not Go Gong Sing's day. And Letta, of course, it's pretty cool. The players have these little sheets on the back of their passes where they can keep track of their matches and their bans and stuff.
Yeah. I saw that actually. Okay, let's get this right this time, the bans. So apparently Letta's Warlock is banned, so we're not going to see Letta's Warlock.
Which makes much more sense, because Go Gong Sing's lineup is much worse against Zoo, because his Dragon Warrior is a single Ravage Ghoul Dragon Warrior. Temple Mage and Midrange Shaman both can struggle against Zoo, especially the Midrange Shaman that Go Gong Sing has, which is the Trog version. And he doesn't have like Rogue or Druid, which would like increase his win rate against
It makes more sense
Zoo sometimes.
And Go Gong Sing's Shaman was banned. Yeah. I keep calling him Go-Go. Go-Go.
Go-Go?
Go-Go is a lot easier to say.
Yeah.
So yeah, and you can see that Letta was wearing his Myth shirt. Which
M-I-T-H.
Is, yeah, Myth. Or is it not M-I-T-H?
It's M-I-T-H.
Oh, I
it's
M-I-T-H.
It, myth. Yeah.
It stands for Made in Thailand.
Yeah, yeah. So they don't like... I was told they don't like when people pronounce it Myth.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
It sounds cool.
It does sound cool. It would be cool, but people don't like it.
Okay. M-I-T-H.
M-I-T-H sounds cool. Sounds cool as well.
M-I-T-H. Sounds like a college.
Yeah, well, MIT is a college.
Yeah.
And H would be, I don't know, the Hearthstone version of, of MIT. Yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
If only MIT had a Hearthstone division.
Right, definitely. That would be cool. Imagine a Hearthstone school. What kind of school would it be like?
Well, there are some colleges that give scholarships for esports now.
That's true.
But it's mostly like, there's a lot involved in it. It's not an actual scholarship like you would normally think for like academics.
I'm thinking more of like a fantasy side where like it's kind of like Harry Potter but for Hearthstone, and like there's different classes that you can take to learn different classes like Warlock.
I don't know if anybody ever told you, Pather, but Harry Potter's not real.
I know. I said fantasy.
Okay. Just wanted to make sure. But yeah, tied up 1-1 now. And looks like we're about to jump into game number 3. Interested to see how GoGoGuns is going to bounce back from that one. Because that's a brutal loss.
I know.
Wouldn't have even tapped. Because, he wasn't 100% dead yet. Because Letta still had to have damage from hand, I think. But we're going to move into Zoo versus Shaman. Letta's Shaman is mid-range, but it's a little bit different than normal mid-range because it runs Tunnel Trog and Faceless, Flamery Faceless, which is sort of the classic mid-range Shaman. Not classic, but mid-range Shaman from like 2 months ago, as opposed to the current mid-range Shamans, which like have been cutting Trog and cutting Flamery Faceless and running like Spirit Claws and Azure Drakes. In place of those in slots.
Yeah, and Letta's Shaman has an Alakir instead of the Doomguard. The Doomhammer. They usually have if they have the Doomhammer, they don't have Alakir.
Yeah.
And vice versa.
But Gogong Sing's early hand is atrocious. It's really bad.
Oh, no.
That's like the worst hand that you could possibly get. And it would make it even worse is if his next card was Second Soulfire or Doomguard.
Well, I think he feels okay now that he just sees a hero power on turn two. He has to play.
He's so fed up with the Silverware Golems that he's just playing them on three.
Right.
That's rough.
Yeah, now his wolf can't... Oh. His wolf can't even kill this Trog. He's going to have to Soulfire this down. He could Defender of Argus and just trade, actually.
Yeah, Defender of Argus is a very hard card to use in this matchup because it's all about the board. So if you can hit one minion, then you should be in a good spot. Searing Totem is a little awkward, actually, for Gogong Sing.
Yeah, it's not what he wanted to see.
Yeah.
Oh, his power cards just got discarded.
Yeah. But I actually like minions. Be honest, the minions aren't too bad. Yeah, base is getting punished by Hex, but
that's good ordering. Getting the Doom Guard attack before sacrificing his wolf. He could Letta could actually hero power, and then or actually drop the Flame Tongue, and then like drop Thing from Below so that if Doom Guard dies.
Yeah. I think this is probably going to be the best Hex target that you can get, though.
That is true. He did see, like, a Soulfire and a Power Overwhelming get discarded, though. Yeah,
so
this is
I think you might as well just get it out of the way. Not give Gogong Sing any chance to get more value out of the Doomguard if you know that you want to remove it anyway. And here powering with a Thankful Bill in your hand makes you able to get a swing turn. Because sometimes instead of playing, like, Thing from Below on 4, if you're ahead in the game, it's better to play it for 0 later on in combination with other things so that your opponent can't just remove one thing a turn. The turn that you play it, you're protecting smaller important minions with it. So definitely like to try and hold on to that to make it much cheaper.
Yeah, and we can see it's actually getting... It's down to 3 now.
Yeah, next turn you can go down to 1 with Flame Tongue plus a Totem up, so...
Let's see what we get from the Dark Peddler here.
I'd like to see his choices, because Reliquary Seeker's probably not going to get that much value.
Yeah, I mean, there's no ritual in here. He's going to try and I don't think he's ever going to have a full board to play this Reliquary Seeker.
I mean, it depends what he draws next turn. I mean, if he taps into two minions, then yes. Two playable minions. Like, if he draws a minion and then has a playable minion. But having two playable minions that you can play for four mana at this stage in the game is not the most likely thing in the world. I mean, I guess his deck is less spells now. So, and he realizes that he's kind of behind of the point where he should be in this matchup, where he can usually run away with the board early on. So maybe he thinks that he needs to take a risk and hope that he draws into two playable minions the following turn to get it to be a 5/5. So, ooh. Soulfire, that's awkward.
Well, yeah, this makes him want to play the Seeker first before Soulfire.
I mean, it's still just a 1/1.
And then just tap and see what he gets.
He can clear the board here, actually, almost.
Ooh, that's a nice pickup. Can even play whatever he gets. He could get a Mortal Coil.
Maybe stick it right now if he wants to play on Lightning Storm, but I think Lightning Storm blows you out anyway. You're not winning if he Lightning Storms.
Exactly.
So just go for it.
Yeah. And actually, he's pretty lucky that Leta doesn't have his Lightning Storm yet.
I don't think Leta actually runs Maelstrom Portal. So that's
you don't think so?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, Leta seems to have like these classic kind of decks.
Yeah. He doesn't like the new cards. He doesn't like Spirit Claws. Actually, he might have had Spirit Claws.
Just going to clear the board.
And get rid of all the totems, which is a big deal. Ooh, Fire Elemental.
But do you play probably the Fire Ellie and just get rid of the Taunt and then just trade into the 2/1. Otherwise your Squire would have been useless there.
Yeah. He really needs something big here to play. I guess Imgang Boss is the best he can hope for. But Alec here feels like it's just going to wreck this board.
It hurts to trade because, you know, if Leta just gets a Lightning Storm, here we go, it's going to hurt a lot.
Yeah, but to be honest, Gogongsing's actually sort of vetted his deck for a lot of the small minions. He doesn't have many one drops left. He doesn't really have... He's got a lot of the meat left. He's got a Doomguard left, he's got a Soulfire left. Or no, he doesn't have a Soulfire left, he's got a Silverware Golem left. I mean, I guess he still has a Voidwalker, Malkazir's Imps, but...
You can see Gogongsing's face.
Yeah.
It's like, I don't want to sacrifice any more of my minions. But I feel like Leta put that out so that he can trade the Imp Gang into it, and then Lightning Storm. Ooh, but then there's another one.
Yeah, I don't think this game is over yet, though. Lightning Storm can do a lot, but it won't clear everything. It will still leave the imp up. Now it'll clear a lot. But
well, he could Rock Biter first, right? And then Lightning Storm?
Yeah, but it'll still leave 2/1/1s.
Yeah.
It might be the best play. But then he gives Gogongsing pretty much full initiative.
He could just drop his Valiant Bluff after that.
Yeah. So Doomguard would be so good for Gogongsing right now.
Yeah.
Because it would basically mean he's drawing two cards a turn, whereas Leta is drawing one and has no cards in his hand. So let's see. Gets Direwolf Alpha. And nope. Silverware Golem, that's not good.
Yeah, he's just going to have to play everything, though. I mean, Leta's going to be hero powering every turn, and Gogongsing wants a board to be able to deal with those pesky totems.
Yeah.
And they're both down to 17 HP. The expert.
Yikes.
Wow.
All right, well... That's probably going to be irrecoverable from Gogongsing.
Right.
And Flame Whip is not what he wants to see at this stage in the game.
Yeah, when you're low on health, it's like you're gonna do more damage to your face using a flame imp, but you have no choice. Oh, so did someone not end their turn yet? That's Go-Go-Sing.
Yep, he's just deciding whether or not he can afford to trade into Thunderbolt Valiant. But if he doesn't trade into Thunderbolt Valiant, he takes at least 11 next turn. Because the Wrath of Air totally buffed up to 4 with the hero power. So I think he's really just trying to think, like, how do I win?
Can he even still win?
I like the value trades.
Wow.
Okay.
That's really tough. He can actually play everything. Might as well play everything.
Yep.
So Go-Gong-Sing can be like, you know what? This game is over.
Go-Gong-Sing. I don't know what he was expecting. There's not many bad draws at this stage in the game for the Shaman deck that Leta has. Maybe like Tunnel Trog would have been the best, but
I just like watching his reactions.
Yeah, he's very expressive.
Definitely.
All right, well, Leta is going to take game three and go up to a 2-1 lead. One game away from moving on to the lower bracket finals, where he'll guarantee himself at least fourth,
yeah.
I think.
And that fourth is still pretty good. You get Hearthstone points, you get cash.
Yeah.
It's like, it's the same as being third. Same HCT points, same amount of cash.
HCT points don't really matter too much at the moment because they don't carry over. And Last Call is effectively closed for every player. Throne and GCT Turth were the only two. Throne made it pretty far. He made it to the lower bracket round of 16, which is like top 24 in the tournament. But it's not enough to get into the HCT points and definitely not enough to push him into Last Call. He actually needed to win the tournament in order to get enough points to qualify for Last Call.
Yeah,
so.
But he's actually out already, right?
Yeah, he is. And so, but the money's nice, and also just the bragging rights, the prestige of winning a major in your home region. And especially for Leta, who's, like, you can tell he's actively trying to build his Hearthstone career and his resume, you know, practicing enough to win the Southeast Asia Preliminary, and now here to make it all the way to the top 6 players out of an open field of 128. Is a pretty big deal.
Yeah, he's actually proving himself to be kind of consistent. Especially, like I said earlier, he's like the Southeast Asia summer champion. And then now he's actually climbing really far in this tournament. So he's definitely a good player representing Thailand.
All right, well, potentially the last game of the series, Go-Gong-Sing versus Leta. Leta's going to have the Druid left, and Go-Gong-Sing has the Tempo Mage, and this is the deck that I've been looking forward to. It's a Tempo Mage, but it runs Medivh, 2 Flame Strikes, and a Blizzard.
Ooh, that's going to be interesting. Living Roots out on turn 1. It's always kind of scary to use your Living Roots like that and create saplings because of Arcane Missiles. I always find it nice to kill it, use it to kill like a Sorcerer's Apprentice or something.
Yeah, the only reason you play Living Roots on turn 1 in this situation is to push damage. But I don't think it's worth it because the biggest threats you have against this deck are 2 mana 3/2s. So being able to just kill it instead of having to worry about, you know, the mage pinging them off and then playing the 2 mana 3/2s is beneficial. He does get the Wrath, which protects them.
Yep.
But I don't know if it's worth it to push 3 damage in order to do that, especially since he's really not doing anything. Now the second one's just going to get pinged off, and now he doesn't have Living Roots as a piece of removal for this game. This game's not about pushing damage. Well, maybe. Leta does have a classic token druid with Nyxia, Wisps of the Old Gods, and Cenarius.
You know what? And he doesn't run Yogg in his druid. Some people will say, that's a mistake. Yogg is too good in this meta.
It's also a dead card in your hand for a large portion of the game.
Yeah. He actually won with like the same decks. So, and he also didn't have Yogg. when he won the Southeast Asia Summer Prelims. Yeah. So he's being loyal to the decks he won with.
Yeah. If you run Savage Roar, I feel like Yogg can be a liability sometimes in your deck because you need stuff to place on the board.
It's probably just going to be hero power here.
I don't really know why he played a Sorcerer's Apprentice here. If he doesn't have a turn 4 play, you're giving him an excuse to kill it. And pinging this is almost effectively the same because Sorcerer's Apprentice, if you play two spells, automatically makes up for its cost the following turn. And if Gorgonsing was planning to throw spells, I also don't like playing Flamewaker on an empty board.
Because of the swipe.
Leta's hand was obviously bad early on, so giving him an excuse to kill high priority minions like this, not so sure.
I guess the swipe could wait, yeah, definitely. Draws three cards. And a swipe and a hero power later is okay. Especially since he's got Innervate also in his hand.
He's gonna leave it up though. Here's the Blizzard. Time for the damage push.
Yeah, see the swipe is actually really good in this position.
Yeah. Wow, Violet Teacher Innervate swipe is actually really sick.
I like that a lot. Pay attention, class. Clearing the Flame Waker and the Thalnos with its spell damage is a good feeling.
And next turn, if the Violet Teacher doesn't get dealt with, Leta can just play Wisps of the Old Gods.
Yeah.
And it summons the 1-1 and buffs everything by a 2-2. So Violet Teacher becomes a 5-7 and it'll have 3/3s on the board. So I think Gorgonsing realizes it's going to play Firelance board, a really great pickup. And that's
an okay minion.
A little bit below average. There.
Yeah, it's okay. Ooh. He could play the 1-1s. Oh, but he's got the Blizzard, and Leta knows that, and also the Flame Strike. He knows, they know each other's deck lists, so I'm sure he's thinking about that. Get some Phandral value here.
He picks up Wrath.
That would actually be great.
A huge board swing. Cavalier Raider is also really good.
Yeah, it's actually the best one out of them. Mulch is good for dealing with Medivh, but would he want Innervate to play anything else in this turn?
He could Mire Keeper, get the Mana Crystal and the 2-2.
Choosing to do just that.
Also play very heavily into Blizzard.
I mean, yeah, this is actually... Well, the Flame Strike doesn't kill the Phandral, but... Blizzard...
Arcane Missiles might.
Blizzard Arcane Missiles. Or you just trade in the 4-3 into the 3-3. And just ping it down later. The Mire Keeper.
Or just try and get it caught up in a Flame Strike the next turn. I mean, I think Medivh's being played next turn, so he wants to remove everything off the board right now.
Mm-hmm.
He's going to try and roll Medivh into Flame Strike, into a bunch of spells.
This turn might be a... Could be Wisps of the Old Gods, since he's seen the Blizzard, that one Blizzard that he was dodging. Because he's not too upset if he uses Flame Strike on this. 7/7.
Yeah, it's a card for a card. And if Gorgonsing doesn't clear it, he just wins.
Right.
Leta just wins. So.
It's a great pickup because now he's left with a minion, even after Flame Striking. Soul of the Forest. Classic token druid card that back in the day.
Yeah. This is actually really... it's kind of annoying that he drew the Soul of the Forest and the Power of the Wild right after he played his only copy of Wisps. So it looks like he's going to Power of the Wild and Arcane Giant if he's mousing over the Power of the Wild for a 3-2. actually quite scary if you're Gogonk Sting, because you know that he has Savitar in this deck.
Yeah, that's true. Well, it sounds so pretty. Ooh. It's gonna have to Frostbolt the, yeah, Arcane Giant and trade into the Panther.
Blade Cultist.
Well, yeah, play the Arcane Blast. Or actually, oh, yeah, that's fine.
Not the best use of Medivh, though.
Yeah.
3-1 drops is not so good.
Ooh. It's a wisp.
Actually, there's 0 drops because it doesn't take the cost of the spell. It takes the cost of how much you cast the spell for. So it ends up being 0 mana instead of 1 mana. And his Frostbolt ended up being 1 mana instead of 2 mana.
Oh, that is just nuts. Because I didn't even realize that until you said it.
Because of the Sorcerer's Apprentice that was on the board. So.
Yeah.
Not the best showcase for Medivh. I'm a little disappointed. But, I mean, Gogonk Sting still has a shot in this game. It's going to be tough. Enjoy raiding. I mean, Leta's still got 2 big threats on the board. And going to go with the 1-1s here to try and put this... +1/+1 to put this Arcane Giant out of range of anything. If he trades to the Medivh, he wouldn't be able to ping up the Arcane Giant unless he picks up extra damage.
Yeah, actually, Leta had lethal already. Well, unless Gogonk Sting dealt with his minions. The Mirror Images was a nice pickup, stopping this Arcane Giant from hitting the face. Ooh.
Yikes. I mean, Leta can just be patient here. He can nurse his turn if he wants to.
Does he want to play Teacher with it?
Yeah, Teacher Soul of the Forest gives you... I guess this is, yeah.
It's okay, too. And you just hear powers and then, like...
Yeah, I mean, I think he has plenty of time. I feel like he could have nourished first.
Right.
Because he still would have had a 3-5 and a 1-1, and also the Arcane Giant. He just would have had 3 extra cards. He might be able to combo and get a bigger board to deal with and Cold Sorcerer's... There's actually a lot of bad top decks for Gogonk Sting at this stage in the game.
Yeah, Arcane Intellect would be good, though.
It would be. It'd be great.
Ooh. Is this going to be it?
I mean, I think it's time for Leta to just... I think he just cruise control the rest of this game.
It's not lethal yet. So he's going to have to draw cards. And when your opponent draws more cards and you don't have any cards, it's not a good feeling.
Yeah. And it can close his eyes and click buttons and probably still come out on top. He's just going to load up the board as much as possible, set it for a Savage Roar next turn.
There's a lot of options for Leta right now, basically. Draw, yeah. Draw, and more draw.
Gogonk Sting is vigorously tapping at his head. But I don't really think that much is going to get him out of this one. He needs exactly Flame Strike, and even then, Leta's just going to play Onyxia or play Cenarius and then win the following turn. So, should be the end of the line for Gogonk Sting.
Well, that was pretty fast. I mean, what he needs is Yogg. Oh my goodness, that's actually really good. And then if he gets his Yogg, he has a chance to come back.
Yeah.
Possibly.
He needs exactly Yogg next turn in order to win the game.
Raven and Idol first. That extra mana. Oh, wow. More damage. You can hear them outside going wild.
How much damage is this? There's 4 on the board. Savage Roar is 6. That'd be 10. Swipe would be another 4, so that'd be 14, and Living Roots would be another 2, so that'd be 16. So not quite, but I mean, yeah. Pretty much anything that he takes there wins him the game even more the next turn. So
yeah.
Gogonk Sting needs exactly Yogg's right, and he needs to do something crazy.
No, it's not the Yogg. It's not the Yogg. Oh, and that came too late. Arcane Intellect.
Fireball into Fireball, and Gogonk Sting pings and concedes, and Leta moves on. to the lower bracket finals.
Wow.
And a tie player. There's still, what, three tie players still left in the tournament?
Jackpot is another tie one.
Is BH Warwind from Thailand?
I'm not quite sure, actually. And but I wouldn't be surprised.
At least two. So secures himself at the very worst, fourth place, which is very impressive for Leto. So he's going to move on. And Gohan Singh, he put up a great performance.
Yeah, I know. I kind of feel like he just had the short end of the stick there. Like, the other two matches were very, very close. Mm-hmm. And then in that one, he just ran out of cards.
Well, I felt like he should have gone up 2-0. I mean, he had two chances to effectively win the match against Rogue and lost both of the 50-50s with the Silver Regalm and the Soulfire. And discarded a crucial card in the matchup. So, and we actually have a replay of exactly that moment that's going to happen here. And I feel like this is where everything went wrong for Gohan Singh. If this Soulfire right here discards Silver Regalm, he wins the game because he tapped into Abusive Sergeant. He would have been able to Soulfire again and then tap, get Abusive Sergeant. It was the only way he could win the game. And Leto was able to only needed 2 points of damage that turn in order to win.
Yeah, I mean, even something like that could have actually changed the whole game. Like,
well, it did. He would have won that turn.
Exactly.
And earlier in the game, he had another situation where he could have gotten it out for free and kept Defender of Argus, which would have won in the game as well, almost certainly.
Discard lock failed him today.
That's sort of the risk that you take playing that deck. It does have inconsistencies.
But when you get it, you feel amazing.
When you get it, you can't lose. But when you don't get it, you always lose. So
that's true.
A little bit rough. But definitely some fun decks showcased for Gohan Singh with Discard Zoo plus Medivh Temple Mage had its debut for us at the Thailand Major with a Blizzard and two Flame Shark Stone in there. Very interesting deck. Mm-hmm.
Guys, please don't forget to tweet. Make your tweets. Hashtag Hearth SEA Major. So tweet about who you think is going to win, your favorite moments, anything really.
Yeah, the tournament's winding down, so you guys can really latch on to players that you enjoy watching. I mean, you can hear the home crowd really cheering for Leto whenever he gets up on the stage. I don't want to call him a local hero. I feel like that might be a little bit excessive, but he's definitely well-respected, and he's fun to watch, well-liked among the community here, really rallying behind him. It's good for Thailand, it's that they have a player that's going to be representing them coming up at one of the championships, and a guy that's making it really far with some very impressive play throughout the tournament. So definitely got to keep your eye on if you're not already watching him. And Gohan Singh too, he's a player that's been around the scene for a long time. I know we were saying earlier he had like a Cthulhu Warrior deck that he took to very high rank. I thought it was rank one, but he might have gotten rank one, just not finished rank one. Mm-hmm. Very early on in Whispers of the Old Gods that I played. So,
good ladder player, you said earlier, right?
Very good ladder player.
And he streams, so you can check out his stream.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But we do have plenty more Hearthstone action to come on the day. We got Losers Semifinals, Losers Finals, and of course the Grand Final coming up. We are going to crown a champion today. Before we jump into the next match, we're going to have to go to a quick break, but don't go anywhere, guys. More Hearthstone Major from Thailand right after this.